गुड आफ्टरनून सर.
थैंक यू सर.
कृष्णा हाउ आर यू?
आई एम गुड सर. हाउ आर यू?
फ्रॉम हैदराबाद.
यस सर, वी हैव अ मिड टर्म ब्रेक गोइंग ऑन.
मिड टर्म ब्रेक फ्रॉम हाउ लॉन्ग?
फॉर अ वीक.
फॉर अ वीक. यू हैव कंप्लीटेड योर ट्रेनिंग और
इट्स गोइंग ऑन.
ट्रेनिंग इज फॉर हाउ मेनी मंथ्स?
सो इट्स फॉर लाइक 11 मंथ्स.
11 मंथ्स. देन यू हैव ब्रेक.
Then we'll go for the district practical training.
Which is your cadre?
West Bengal, sir.
West Bengal. That after this break will go?
No. So I'll go to West Bengal in December.
Okay. Now.
I'll go straight away to Hyderabad.
So how many months training you are completing?
Around six.
Around six. Okay. And you have Bharat Darshan also?
Bharat Darshan is in the phase two. So I'm currently in the phase one.
Okay. Phase two is how many months?
It's around 2 months.
So how is physical training there?
Exhausting, sir. Yeah, it's difficult.
Tough,
no doubt.
So, but you don't have this physical training in your career. This is there and that's all. That's
but,
why you find pot belly persons, even IPS officers also.
But a lot of us actually adopt it in our daily habits.
Mm.
So many of us are still running in our midterm break, because this is something which has become a routine.
No, it's okay. Training time is okay. You are forced to. Till your second phase is there, you are forced to have that. I'm telling afterwards.
So I hope to remain the same. I want to have it as a good takeaway.
No. But what are the views that during career also, like in military, they have this endurance test. Should it be there in police also?
I think it should not be made compulsory. Rather, people should try to inculcate this in their habits.
Try to? How many have been inculcating? These observations are being made even by the courts also. You find pot belly inspectors and others, and many of the IPS officers also. It doesn't happen in army, but they have mandatory endurance test after 2 years. They have to maintain their health, otherwise they are out.
Right. So even in the paramilitary forces, there's the endurance test. Even in police, in some states, there is an endurance test. But no one is permanently retired. But people are posted to positions which are non-field positions. Having said that, if I take the case of IPS per se, I'll say that largely we'll be occupying the decision-making positions. So and which are going to be really hectic. So, making a test mandatory for people would be too rigid.
Decision making positions is okay, but don't you think when emergencies need, they have to go to the field also?
Yes, no doubt, sir.
And they have to walk also. Then it becomes very difficult for them.
Sir, I think if I want to be a good administrator, if I want to be a good police person, I should be fit. This is something which should
come. This is all right, personal level, it's all right. I'm telling. Whether it should be mandatory or not.
No,
because
it should
unless,
not be.
Unless it is mandatory, there is no guarantee. And especially in the cadres of North India, where they are in the habit of enjoying life and all, which is not there in South. So it will be like that, which is there now.
Sir, I feel, I'm sorry sir, I beg to differ. I strongly feel that one these things should not be imposed on some person. Rather, the person should inculcate these things in themselves. Because if I want to be a good administrator, I have to be fit.
So it means the officers having pot bellies, DGs and all, they don't want to be good administrators.
Probably they have different priorities. Many of them, in fact, my director is a DG rank officer. He runs every day. This is something that should come from within. No one could teach a DG rank officer.
Okay. You know, police reforms were there as per that Supreme Court judgment. And now selections of DGs in the state and of police forces made by the EPC. Do you think this type of system is required or it is against the spirit of federalism, the chief minister doesn't have any powers. Whereas this selection was previously being done at the state level and it was working well. And I don't think it is making much difference. Because again they have to send a panel of 3 officers. This is also the same thing.
Firstly, UPSC is a constitutional body. It's like a federal commission. So it represents both the union as well as the state characteristics. So I won't completely agree that the powers have been taken from the state. Secondly, there's a panel of three, so the chief ministers still have a prerogative on who to choose. Having said that, if you say that the judgment is not being implemented in its spirit, I will say that policing is something that has to be...
I'm not talking about judgment is not being implemented. I simply talk about this particular aspect.
Right, sir.
I didn't talk about other reforms. I'm just mentioning only this. But this is causing delay.
Yes.
A lot of delay is being caused. When you can, state government can select a chief secretary, why not a DGP?
So in this case, I would like to cite what Supreme Court said, and it made a clear distinction between how the post of chief secretary is different from the post of DGP. DGP heads a police force, and a police force has to be necessarily separated from the direct control of the political executive, because eventually it's a force. It has to be, it commands violence, and therefore it has to be impassionate at times. So a DGP should be someone who is politically neutral. Having said that, it's the political executive that should guide and supervise it, but eventually it should have certain autonomy.
Means that condition is being fulfilled after UPSC selections are made for UPSC?
To some extent, sir.
We have a number of cabinet committees, and we have empowered group of ministers. What is the difference between them?
So there are cabinet committees are more permanent. So they are over a particular sector. Say a cabinet committee on security or a cabinet committee on infrastructure. Yes, political affairs. On the other hand, EGOMs or Empowered Group of Ministers is basically for a certain subject. It's temporary, and as it is for a more specific understanding and analysis of a particular issue. It might be a bill, it might be a specific reform that the government is targeting. So it's temporary. Once the task is done, it dissolves.
What is the major difference?
While the cabinet committees are permanent, the EGOMs.
These committees are recommendatory bodies, whereas cabinet committees are decision making.
Right.
This is the major difference. Okay. Roles of UPSC, one role we discussed. Tell me other 3-4 roles.
So one is of course the selection of the recommendation of Group A officers to be selected by the Government of India. Then it has a role in disciplinary matters. In case any Group A officer, some disciplinary action has to be taken, the advice of UPSC is taken. Then UPSC could also perform the recruitment functions for state governments. So wherever there is no state public service commission, UPSC could perform that function. That's it, sir.
What is biodiversity?
So biodiversity is the total accumulation of all the flora and fauna in a particular ecosystem.
How much we have in India, roughly?
Are
we rich in biodiversity?
Yes, sir. We are a mega diverse country. So
approximately how many species of plants and animals in India?
I'm not sure, sir.
No, sir. We have good chunk of forest.
Yes.
Roughly how much?
So the number is around 23%. I'm not sure of the categorization per se.
Have you heard of one principle of equity and common but differentiated responsibilities and responsibilities?
Yes, sir.
Where it is being applied?
So this is being applied in the Conference of Parties of UN Framework on Climate Change. So common but differentiated responsibilities mean that both the developing as well as the developed world have common responsibilities of preventing catastrophic climate change, but at the same time, it's the responsibilities are differentiated.
Okay. This, okay. Just tell me, you are founding member of Computer Society of India?
No, sir. It should be founding member of the Finance and Economic Society at college.
Okay.
I was an executive board member of the CSI.
Krishan.
Sir.
Do you read newspapers?
Yes, sir, whenever I get time at the
academy. I came across an interesting concept today. It was basically saying that there is a difference between anthropocentric jurisprudence and biocentric jurisprudence. Can you think, what is this?
The basic difference I see is the jurisprudence which is largely defined by natural causes versus what is defined by human interventions. So I'm not very sure on that.
Is our judiciary more in favor of anthropocentric factors? Does it also take into consideration the biocentric factors which surround it?
It does, sir.
Is there a bias towards anthropocentric jurisprudence?
To the contrary, I feel our judiciary has been really proactive, and it has India's jurisprudence is actually very proactive when it comes to biocentric jurisprudence.
Can you give me some biocentric laws or initiatives?
Sir, if I take one example, it would be the MC Mehta case, where the Supreme Court banned the refineries near Taj Mahal. And so in that case, Supreme Court said that even though there are refineries like the Mathura refinery, they are causing pollution and they are harming the ecosystem around the Taj Mahal. So
you've got West Bengal cadre. That should be a difficult place for police officers to work, looking at what is happening in Bengal.
It will be an interesting place for sure. I'm not sure about being difficult.
There's a lot of politicization of police in West Bengal.
That's something which I'll say is happening across the country. It's something which will happen. There's always a fear.
If you have to summarize the four major reforms that's required in policing in the country, what would it be?
The first one, of course, is the condition of the constabulary. In my interactions at various paramilitary forces as well as the state police forces, I've found that not just the constabulary suffers from the problem of low remunerative incomes, they also suffer from the problem of mental and physical health issues. The second one, of course, would be the reforms at the top level. That might be the selection of the post of DGPs or the district superintendents. There should be more autonomy, there should be a security of tenure. The third would be greater autonomy. And by autonomy, I do not mean less accountability, rather greater autonomy for police chiefs to exercise power. There should be lesser political interference and more of political guidance. Fourth area would be in the criminal investigation. I think there's an urgent need to separate the law and order and investigation duties. We have at NPA a lot of simulations where we try to learn how a good investigation is done, how it is done in countries outside India. And I realize that in India, police people are so burdened with investigation, with law and order duties, that the evidence collection, the forensics, which are very, very important for high quality investigation, are missing. So
you have been under training for 6 months. What is it that they don't teach you at the academy, and what should they be teaching? You have to find out something.
That's a difficult question, if I say something. In fact, we have given a lot of feedbacks, and the academy has been really accommodative. So we talked about having an election. The previous batch talked about having an election attachment. For this batch, they ensured that we have one. Having said that, I think because of COVID, we missed out on a lot. We could not get a lot of practical insights into how a thana works, different function, how police commissionerates and police districts basically manage complex functions like traffic and other things. We used to have such attachments. We are not having them right now because of COVID.
You have mentioned classic fiction and contemporary Indian nonfiction. What do you read in contemporary Indian nonfiction?
So a lot of stuff, things about India's history, things about...
If you have to say one book that you have recently read.
So that's not a purely contemporary Indian non-fiction. I read Perilous Interventions by Shri Hardeep Singh Puri.
Can you tell us 2-3 takeaways from the book?
So it's basically about the role of UNSC and how it impacts countries in general. So there's in fact an element on India also, how UNSC is a very political body, and many of the interventions it makes in countries, including its stand in countries like Libya, Syria, and even in Kashmir, were highly political. So they were basically influenced by the opinions and whims of the P5 countries, which is the permanent members, and ignores the actual needs of the country.
Is it time to dissolve the UN? Does it have any contemporary relevance?
Sir, the book?
UN, United Nations.
No doubt it has.
Do you think it is playing its role it was intended to?
Sir, to a good extent, UN has played an important role. I agree that there's a need of reforms. The present day UN doesn't reflect the realities of our times. But this doesn't mean that UN doesn't have a role in peacekeeping, or there are UN forces in very turbulent areas of the world. There are UN agencies which are doing really good work. So I think if there is any need, there's a need to make UN more proactive, more robust, and more reformed.
What is your take on encounters?
Sir, by encounters, I understand that you are referring to extrajudicial killings.
Yeah.
So I think any kind of killing is not justified, especially if it is done by the police force. There's only one provision in the Indian Penal Code which allows such an action, but that is an exception to the rule. So I do not, I think all the convicts, all the accused have to go through the trial. So there's no point of an encounter.
When it comes to police reforms, why governments are always half-hearted in implementing the reforms? What do you think the probable reason?
So the reason which I feel is, of course, that governments exercise a lot of power through police, and they do not want to give away that power. And so there's a vested interest involved, and therefore police reforms are slow. That doesn't mean that they are not happening.
So what is the security arrangements in coastal areas? And what is the role of police?
Sir, by coastal areas, do you mean the coastal policing or the regions per se?
Coastal police. There is a recommendation by Kargil committee how coastal areas should be strengthened. And clearly demarcating the role between different forces, right? Can you elaborate on that?
So I'm not exactly sure of the facts. I do understand that there's a jurisdiction of state police to some extent and Indian Coast Guard, and a lot of reforms have been made in coastal policing after the 2008 Bombay attacks. I'm not sure of the exact facts.
Do you know something about NatGrid? What is NatGrid?
So NatGrid is like a master database of that collects inputs from all the intelligence agencies. It collates them and it uses a lot of big tech like big data analysis, and provides the same feed to 10 intelligence agencies in India.
What is the due process and process laid down by the law?
So this differentiation was made by the Supreme Court in the Menaka Gandhi judgment. A procedure established by law or a process laid down by the law is basically that there could be certain restrictions which could be placed as per the law.
It is laid down by Supreme Court in Menaka Gandhi's case, or it is in the Constitution itself?
The word due process, sir?
No, the procedure.
Yes, sir. It's in the Constitution, Article 21.
Oh.
The differentiation has been made in the differentiation between due process and procedure established has been made in the Menaka Gandhi. Due process would basically mean abiding by the principles of natural justice.
What are they?
So there are two basic principles. One should not be condemned unheard, and no one should be a judge in their own cause.
Enough of police. I think let us go to some international relations.
I'm going to NP anyway, so there'll be a lot of police there.
I know, but you will be grilled on policing mode. That's why every one of us are trying. What is your take on India's position on RCEP?
So in 2019, India decided to leave the negotiations for RCEP. So as the things stand right now, the 15 members, the 15 countries are going ahead with it, and India is out of RCEP. So if you are asking about my take on it, I think trade deals are something which is desirable. But we should not enter into trade deals only because we have to enter into them. We have to enter into a club of nations which are trading with each other. It has to be in our terms.
What
should
the pluses and minuses of the RCEP?
So RCEP as it stands right now is going to benefit countries which are more, which have a strong manufacturing ecosystem. So of course there'll be tariff relaxations, there'll be greater trade facilitation between those countries. India's stand has been that it should include share for services, and it should include items where India has a good export basket.
Okay. Over the years, in recent 6 or 7 years, there is a widespread feeling that India is not able to maintain its relationship, a good relationship, even with its neighbors. Do you agree with this statement?
Sir, I feel that India has made the best efforts to have good relations with its neighbors. But as the basic rule of international relations go, that you cannot have permanent friendships, and you cannot have permanently good relations with all the countries. Even those smaller neighbors have their own national interests, and therefore they keep on changing. But India has always made the efforts.
Hi, Krishan.
Hi, sir.
So, have you heard about peacekeeping missions?
Yes, sir.
So, where does India play a key role in peacekeeping?
There were, of course, many theaters. One that I fondly remember is Cyprus, where, in fact, India lost a retired general. Apart from that, there was Kosovo. There was Sri Lanka also. So there were many theaters. And there are many countries in Africa where India, Indian forces were a part of peacekeeping missions.
Why do you mean to say that those countries' police forces are and we have been called for peacekeeping? The internal security in the concerned country is threatened. Is it so?
Sir, I think the very idea of peacekeeping is that the force that is deployed should be neutral. Many of those countries were fighting civil wars, where both the parties had legitimate or say claims on the government, claims on the power. And therefore, in order to ensure peace at first, and in order to ensure that women and children and all the vulnerable sections of those societies are protected, there was a requirement of a neutral and efficient police force. And that is the reason why UN has been deploying those UN peacekeeping missions.
Okay. So, there are still internal security problems in India, like nationalism. When we cannot able to control our own problems, why do we get into peacekeeping missions like other countries?
So there are two reasons. Firstly, to the first statement on not being able to control, I was recently attached to the CRPF, and we went to Jharkhand and saw the Naxal issue. I think our forces are doing really good when it comes to solving the Naxal problem. We went to a lot of areas which used to be liberated zones, and India has done a very good work, all thanks to our security forces, because of which development is reaching now. And when I say that the role of security forces is this important, it's important to train them. And we have to train them in different theaters. So if they go in civil war regions where the problems are actually complex, they're going to learn a lot from them. So I think it's a very good training experience for those forces, an experience which they might not always get in India. So of course, one, because of training. Second, it's because of India's commitment to being a responsible international player, which is always committed to ensure international peace.
What is your opinion on community policing? Have India stepped into community policing so far?
So there are some states which have done fine when it comes to community policing. Kerala has in fact implemented a model of community policing. Then there's in Maharashtra, Mohalla committees were experimented. A very good concept in my opinion, and it has actually led to a good number of cases being resolved at the community level only.
My last question. What is a new development bank and why is it created?
So new development bank is a product of BRICS, and it is basically created to assist the developing world in various infrastructural and developmental projects. The larger reason why it might have been created is to create a developmental bank ecosystem apart from the existing institutions, which are largely West dominated, say the World Bank and the IMF.
Okay, good.